It's a very awkward position to have a conversation.
Well, you could sit on the couch across their legs if you really want to.
Yeah, you can come and sit. You can sit on Rick's lap.
Or behind them.
We've done that.
You can make faces. So does it feel strange to be talking about one of Steven's movies without already having made another or about to start another? Or I guess you are about to start another, aren't you?
And War Horse was such a lovely experience, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Mm.
Yeah. Let's talk about War Horse. We know.
Was Lincoln harder than War Horse?
Yes.
No.
No.
So much easier.
Actually, funny enough, I didn't really know.
Oh, no. I'm totally sincere. It was one of the easier movies that I've done.
What?
Lincoln.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think War Horse was really hard too.
Yes, I agree. War Horse
was physically hard. I mean, those locations, it was tough. I mean, it was physically tough, wasn't it? And Lincoln wasn't physically tough in that way. Mm. But actually, the scale and volume and the type of, well, for me, I mean, I'm not talking about anybody else,
but for me,
it was tough. I think actually it's probably one of the hardest films I've ever done. Oh, shut up. Talk for yourself.
Well, you get older when you're older, you know, so it's harder. I can tell, you know, my knees are giving up too a little bit.
Well, I have to say, my knees aren't giving up. But I tell you, the thing is that to do this film, to be perfectly honest, I don't know if you feel the same, but I don't think I could have done it 20 years ago.
Huh.
You know, it was the kind of film that every day, every moment, you used every bit of experience that you'd had on that day, in that moment, and from the beginning to the end.
I really think,
I don't think that, I mean, we'd maybe have done the film, but I don't think it would be quite so.
Well, I've been on this movie for 10 years. 12, actually, you're right.
Yeah.
But the very nature of why you got the responses is because these two had to deal with the people all the time. So does Janusz, but at least he didn't have to be out in one of these locations that I took everybody to in War Horse and made all that difficult filming, you know, in the rain and everything for No Man's Land or even down at the farm, the horse plowing a farm. This was much more controlled, and we actually shot it in Richmond, Virginia in basically five locations, and we just stayed in those places because they all kept everybody kind of focused, especially I think Stephen and Daniel, to be in the character of the time, because in Richmond, Virginia, there's a lot of places that we found that are really very much like they were, with some other dressing and other points of view added. But I think that's one of the reasons that it being a portrait, it was really a big task for Lois and Joanna. And obviously, Janusz is there every moment photographing. Maybe I'm the one who had actually, because I had it spread out over such a long period of time to consolidate it, one of the in a sense, simpler versions. But I would agree with Lois that it took consolidating through that decade, like the script, all the way down into something that was not so broad as it was deep, and it was not so much horizontal as it was a movie, you know, about a man and his immediate people around him.
So you have a lot of people in this movie, a lot of characters that may not have a lot of lines, but are, you know, recognizable characters through the whole thing.
Absolutely, yeah.
So you got to kind of keep everybody going at the highest level all the time.
Yes, and the background too. I mean, especially, you know, obviously in scenes like the House of Representatives, where you have the principal actors with the dialogue interspersed amongst the, 335 on the biggest day, crowd.
But you're also always waiting for like somebody in the background to say something. Because there are actors you recognize enough to know they're going to eventually have a line or six.
Yes.
And you're always seeing them in the background of each shot. So they had to be up to snuff as well.
Oh yeah, we had
extras.
58 cast.
No. We had 104.
No, in the House of Representatives.
Oh, sorry,
in those scenes.
Yeah, it was.
So it was 58 cast, and 335 background for the 8 days, 9 days that we shot interior House of Representatives. But in the cast, we fitted 161, and there are 143 to 147.
So was Daniel the easy one in all of this? I mean, in terms of doing the makeup, in terms of doing the getting him to be Lincoln? Because obviously he's doing his work also. I feel like I'm just extending the non-answer.
I think Daniel's brilliant because he immerses himself totally within a role. So the process for me, and I can't speak for Lois, but the process for me was long, which was great. I wanted to start him way ahead before I started the film. And in fact, I was in the middle of doing a film about giants and fantasy medieval England. And so it was kind of odd to try and sort of start putting my head in Lincoln. But I really wanted to get, you know, immersed within it early on before I had to deal with the rest of the film. You know, I wanted him to have his own platform. And, excuse me, it was a lot of small moves of collective thinking between us, mm-hmm. which was pretty much of the same. But to, in these small moves, just going forward, adjusting to create this image which is in every American's consciousness.
And also, I think all those little moves, they amount to a very simple, very clear silhouette. And that's that. If you really think about the movie, the close-up works. That's the first thing you're watching in the movie, is this going to work or am I not going to buy this? I know what he looks like. And if that first time you see him and then progressively you start to have questions, and I think it comes across right away, just the sort of scruffiness, the way he's wearing, both the makeup, the hair, and what he's doing from the inside, and especially the way it's lit, so that silhouette and that close-up both work really well. And that within the environments, the way it's lit, and this is not just, I don't know what Janusz does. I know that there's light coming through a window, and there's a gas lamp, and that there's some fake lights that appear to be the gas lamp, and I know that there's some candles. But how I'm actually looking at the right thing every single time in the frame with the light, and that the close-up's working, and then when it goes to the silhouette, how that's working, and how sometimes I can see the wallpaper and I care to see the room and what it looks like, but then how sometimes it becomes just a tableau of a silhouette and a haunted person. Those are things that the three of these artists have contributed in a way that I find to be miraculous. And so I'll just say it, because I could set the table in a sense by creating an environment. And when everybody walked in there, I know that we had some conversations, Janusz and I, earlier on, where I had painted the room to look a little like this room with the white trim and the wallpaper. And Janusz just pulled me aside and said, Ricky, it'd be great if you could just tone that trim down a bit, because then I can see the walls. You know, it's really simple in his, and suddenly everything could work. So there's a communication, I think, that we have that I really appreciate, and it makes a big difference. And when I watch the movie, there's a balance between all the things that we're bringing to the image.
So how did you do it, Janusz?
I just want to make sure that everyone understands we're talking about the Lincoln, not the Lincoln Vampire Slayer.
Oh,
the proper Lincoln.
Oh, that's.
Well, I bet that looked pretty good too.
I didn't see it, but I think the guy did not look like Lincoln
much. No, I don't think he was meant to so much.
Okay, then it worked.
Yeah, it worked great at him not looking
like
him.
They succeeded.
They succeeded in not making any money, which was really the painful part.
Well, that's painful.
But I mean, is this? You said it was one of the easier movies you've done.
It was. It was an easy movie to make, because the movie was very static. You know, we shot in a very beautiful location and beautiful set that Ricky constructed. You know, the wardrobe was amazing, the makeup was great, amazing as well, of course, the makeup was amazing. So, you know, if you've got all these elements in front of the camera, in addition to spectacular screenplay and great actors, you know, so you don't have to, you know, you don't have to bend and twist and reinvent the wheel, you know, it's very easy, you know.
Weren't you reinventing the wheel a little bit every time you're going back in period, or?
No. I mean, you just do a little bit of interpretation on the period, but you know, there's certain preconceived knowledge, you know, in the audience, within the audience, they expect certain reality with that particular period. There's enough photography and literature and enough movies made about that period, not just about Lincoln, although there were some movies, but you know, people know what to expect, you know, and for us it was just to give him that sense of reality, you know.
But you know, that's an interesting point, because just to know what's being expected, that's an instinctive thing. You know, you don't calculate all of that. And so if you can fulfill that, and then people can just go with the movie, then there's an unspoken reality right in front of you. And I think the movie actually does that. It's very sort of slow at presenting its exposition, so you understand what's at stake, why it's at stake, and then it starts building from there so that emotionally you can engage in what really matters by the end of the movie. But that sense of what do you expect coming in, I in the beginning thought the suspension of disbelief in this movie was going to be as tough as a T-Rex in Jurassic Park. Only for a entirely different reason. And in fact, I think that people just go with it. You know, when the trailer came out, and everybody said, oh, this voice, this isn't the way he's supposed to sound. Well, by the end of the movie, you would think, well, how else is he supposed to sound? That's him.
That's good, you know, Ricky.
Even to the point where I actually did this in my fourth time seeing the movie. I suggest that you try it, if you should happen to see it that many times. Pull out a $5 bill and decide which one is Lincoln. And you end up, or at least I ended up going, well, that's fine, but that's just a still, and I can look at that anytime. I'm just going to sit and watch him, because that's Lincoln.
What's a fascinating thing when these are done well, I mean, the movie Walk the Line, for example, you know, if you listen to the soundtrack album after having seen the movie, you know, two months later, they sound nothing like Johnny Cash and June Carter Cash, but somehow in the movie, they seem exactly to be hitting the notes just right, and you're like,
how did I convince myself? Lincoln doesn't look like Lincoln?
I have no idea what Lincoln really, I mean, ultimately that's the thing is, I mean, I think Lincoln, this is going to be the embodiment of Lincoln for the next 100 years.
Our Lincoln is the right Lincoln. Not some $5 note.
But also, it is interesting, I think the expectation probably from the audience, if this wasn't directed by Steven Spielberg, what would the audience be, would that expectation be lower?
Or just different, you know, I mean, I think that the thing is that, see, this is where actually I think there's a slight difference, and I don't know, being the American on this group.
I'm American.
That's true.
I am too.
Okay.
You were just privileged to be born here. We had to fight for it.
Well, I just,
we're more Americans than you are.
Well, I grew
like
up.
Like our president.
Born into
wait a minute.
I grew up.
Well, I've been here for 32 years. I grew up in America as well. So retract the comment.
I'm going to retract that comment and say that we Americans,
exactly,
except for this Brit over here.
She still loves the Queen.
No.
Yes.
She looks nothing like Helen Mirren.
What mean? Same hair.
Exactly. Now we all think.
Well, let's just put it this way. Okay, this is getting a little crazy.
Oh, you're supposed to feel like we're in a living room.
Okay.
Okay. Whose living room is this?
So how did you respond to that nothing will make an Englishman shit faster than a portrait of George Washington? I thought that was funny.
I thought that was really funny.
I thought it was really funny.
I think the interesting thing about the movie is that it feels modern. The story feels modern, and sometimes you're actually brought back to it by the visuals, by the, you know, the outfits and everything else, that you kind of reminded that
because
you're in still a period.
But then a true story, when you really get to the essence of humanity, that's exactly what it is. Mm-hmm. I think that you know, obviously there are ways of behavior that are different at different periods in history, but the human condition and the human story remains the same.
Mm-hmm. And also,
almost shockingly more in detail, like the idea of the lobbyists, you know, you don't really think about lobbyists being around that way back then.
But they
and they
were.
Could be Jack Abramoff's, you know, grandparents.
Certainly.
And there's some great grandparents.
You mean he sucked it with the blood?
You're back to Vampire Slayer?
No, he sucked it with the genes, the Abramoff.
Well, I mean, in some ways, he's still that same behavior.
I think it's much worse right now than it was then.
Really?
Maybe.
I don't know.
100% much worse.
Well, it's interesting.
The consequences of the nation are much bigger now, except it's less spoken about, you know.
Mm. No, I don't think so.
Well, I don't know. Obviously.
Because those guys seemed like they were a darker trio before they were working for Lincoln. Ultimately, they kind of stepped up in morality as well as in trying to do the work in this story.
But the other part,
on the
leadership level, that I think is actually what both sides of the equation politically in this country anyway can take from the movie, is that there's a place where compromise is the right thing to do and where holding on to your ideals is the right thing. And that's a very tricky thing that you watch through this movie, him go back and forth, and he wrestles with it. And that's kind of the zone that we find ourselves in. You know, if you say, now, I'm not going to raise taxes, and that's an ideological thing that you're holding to, and it's a principle, and or a compromise that maybe helps things go forward, even in ways you would like to have it go forward, where do you bend? Or the opposite. Mm-hmm. Where, you know, I think that kind of thing is navigated in this movie, and you actually see Lincoln in the screenplay and in the scenes take it to a very fundamental level, which is he goes like this, you know, in mathematics, you know, things that are equal to the same thing are equal to each other. It sounds obvious, self-evident, mm-hmm. but you can build a whole idea of equality based upon that. And then, as he does in the movie, talk about justice and fairness, and that's what it begins with. And that type of thing goes out and still permeates everything we're doing now. So that, I actually think, beyond where we are in this election cycle, and coming off of this new, you know, presidential campaign, that's where I think there's something in this that's for really for everybody. And I don't know whether they'll take it or not, but that's at least there for people to get.
I think also the flip of Republicans and Democrats and how people see themselves and identify, right. you know, as one or the other. People yeah. know Lincoln was Republican, but I don't think they quite realize
how
the sides have flipped completely. Absolutely. And how that can happen again. It could happen 10 years from now.
But you see, I think that the truth of it is there's always something to learn from history. And I don't just mean dates and facts, because the human story is a continuum. And the more you know what those frail humans chose to do and why, mm-hmm. you stand a better chance of not repeating the mistakes. Yeah. That's why it's important. You know, looking back, it's not just about wearing a lovely frock or, you know, having some romantic idea. It's actually a practical tool. It's a mirror that we see the reflection of ourselves in, and we can make different choices. I mean, and I think there's something wonderful about the medium of film, because you see it in a dreamlike state. You see it with a bunch of strangers in the dark and larger than life. And hopefully, you know, your mobile phone's not going and you're not thinking about the gas bill or whatever it happens to be. So actually it speaks to us, to the best and the worst of us inside ourselves. Mm. And I think that's why we get so excited and so passionate and want to make it as best as we possibly can.
Well, I guess like music, it also speaks to people aesthetically and not just in words.
Absolutely.
Though the words are great also in this case, but you know.
No, the words are wonderful.
But you take away the experience more than you take away the literal push of the movie a lot of the time.
Well, and in this movie, it's about Lincoln. And Lincoln is the paradigm of speaking to our better selves, our better yes. angels, and to what's self-evident. We build all these ideas that we have now on these principles. Where did they come from? That's what the movie's about. You actually get to see how the principles were derived and how much it took to do it. It's not just, it didn't just happen. Mm-hmm. So at that part in the movie when he talks about, are we creating something that we might be worthy of later? That's a question to us 150 years later. He didn't know when he's riding through that battlefield for sure that his choices were right. He's responsible for everybody who was dead there. And that's shown to you in the movie. He had to believe that, and he went to see it. He didn't not go look at it. He even went further than the movie. He went into Richmond. And that's why being in Richmond, I think, resonated, at least I believe it did. It certainly did for me, as a way to make it coherent and clear and American to its core. Because just like in the movie, when Blair goes from Washington to Richmond, that 100 miles, that's where most of the Civil War took place. And that all that ground there is where those 700,000 people died. So there's a way that it resonates. It's not just like going after a tax rebate and going down to New Orleans or up to Canada, which I scouted, and saying, oh, let's do it here. And then we'll put a green screen over here and we'll do this over here. And I think that that's the kind of thing that was brought to the movie and condensed over time to find its way to be the right movie. And when Janusz, you say it's simple because at that point, and where you are in your life, in your aesthetic career, and having done War Horse, we could go out and in a day shoot that no man's land and have it not have to be everything that somebody else might want it to be. That would actually be wrong. And that day in particular was an interesting day because we laid out this thing and I tried my best to do it towards the back light so it would all work, and we this foreground, middle ground, background, a road for the crane, all the logistics that you put together. And Stephen came out and went, you know, where's my War Horse no man's land? You know, the, this side and this side. And it really took Janusz and everybody in the camera team, Mitch, to sort of say, well, why don't we start here and do this? And we all collaborated. But it really, ultimately, I think, turned into one of the strongest sequences we've ever done. And it's because it's the culmination of all this work that we did before. Remember, this group essentially goes back to a decade of war movies. We, you know, there's War of the Worlds, there's Munich, there's War Horse, and now there's Lincoln. And those are different aspects of a war we've all been involved in for a decade, since 2001. And what's the leadership that takes us through? And we're exploring it in various ways. And ultimately, there's Lincoln as the paradigm of what leadership actually is. And it's ironic that someone like Thaddeus Stevens says, you know, I'm leading the people, you should try it sometime. It's like a joke to us, because that is leadership, bringing things into being where the people can support it, not just being so far out of it ahead that you don't give a shit about the people and you think you know everything.
So have you all had these conversations with Stephen, or is it just a, does he trust that you know this and you're thinking about it and you're chewing on it and he doesn't need to take you there?
Let's not tell him everything. Let's keep some mystery.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Well, because, you know, and the reason is because we have this dialogue that we all really enjoy. And it's of a type that it only happens over time. And so we could give you some sound bite, but that's not going to be what it's like. It's just, it's a different kind of a thing to be involved for a decade together and making some movies that here we are, you know, at this point, at the end of it, a new chapter is going to begin.
This guy came to me at the premiere. He wanted to know how is it to work with Steven Spielberg. Why would I want to tell you that?
But I think I was saying before with Rick, the unsaid, there's a lot of unsaid between us, but we know. And I think that's very personal. I find that very sweet. And you know, the rather boring restrictions like time and, you know, different geographical restrictions and bloody, but I think that the common thread of what we, you know, as a united force go for is you know, common to all of us probably.
And pretty rare overall. I mean, there's
I don't know. I don't know. You know, you only know from your own experience. So you know what it's like for all in Martin Scorsese's group, or, you know, other. Rick and I cross between Bob Zemeckis and Steven Spielberg, and so I've worked with Rick for a lot of films. We've been connected, so, you know, we're right down there, our roots. And I first worked with Lois on, and Janusz actually on Saving Private Ryan. So it's lovely. It's just
and we know each other. But you see, we know and support each other. Earlier today, you know, the idea of Lincoln comes from, you know, there are elements drawn from the book A Team of Rivals. Nothing could be farther from the truth with us, because we are team. We are Team Lincoln. We were Team War Horse.
I want a T-shirt. Team Lincoln.
I'm Team Obama.
I need to make a T-shirt.
Well, then you're definitely on Team Spielberg. But I mean, do you? Is working with other directors just a completely different experience at this point? Is it just?
Yeah. Every director is different.
Yeah.
Every film is different.
But it's different.
Is Janusz going to answer? Are you going to answer this one or no?
I believe in certain secrets and not revealing too much about other directors and stuff. You know?
But your work, I mean, the work that you do in preparing and getting, you know, getting onto the set before you've ever actually shot the frame of film, has to be more complex with somebody you're not as familiar with, no?
Well, you know, when you get in that nice Cadillac and you're driving that Cadillac, and then you get in the little Yugo, you're still driving, but you still get what you need to get, but you know, not the same.
That's really good.
It is very good.
That is really good. I like that.
See, we can all relate to that, whether you can or not.
Well, I mean, there's literally, you know, as you said, there's very few directors who are in the position and have the history in which they can, you know, bring a team that's this skilled together. I think the first time I met Janusz actually was on a Kinka Usher commercial somewhere with one of something referencing one of Steven's movies, and you know, you'd worked with Kinka before, but you still worked with Steven. I think you said, well, he said, you know, we're going to do something in the spring. That's all you knew at that point. That's all you cared to know, and that was maybe you knew more and you weren't telling me even then. But it does seem like that's a, you know, being able to call the Batcave and get this group of people together anytime, you know, when you need to, is a pretty remarkable asset for him.
But you know, he does make movies every year, one movie almost every year. So,
does he?
Yeah. Well, some exception.
There was that 3-year gap.
Yeah.
We were like 3 years.
We were all lost. We don't know what to do. We get divorced.
Yeah, we were lost.
Wandering the streets.
No, but actually, something in the way you said it made us sound like we were quite an expensive group. And it made it sound, because it, oh, you know, very few directors can get a group of people like this. It makes it sound like we're expensive. I just want you to know that we're not. We're very reasonably priced.
No, I'm actually expensive.
And I'd like to be.
Well, the thing is that
I'll keep some things a mystery.
Yeah. There you go. But you know, you were saying before about whether Steven has there's an advantage or a disadvantage, whether this is a Steven Spielberg film. You know, I think it's a little of both. I think there are people who perk up and, you know, are in love with his work and appropriately,
yes.
You know. But there are also people who, if they saw this film and it wasn't Steven, you know, would assume it was a genius young artist coming up and, you know, doing something on a smaller budget.
But there's no such a case. You know, a genius young artist would never be able to make a movie like that.
Well, agree. That's true. That's a different
thing. That's part of the thing, is
the guy's been making movies for, 40 years?
Yeah.
And I've been making movies with him for 20. And
we're not,
Rick, even
and
longer,
I'm
right?
going to keep something
Rick
younger, secret.
Old, longer?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
How long now, Rick?
30.
Oh my God.
No, I'm, see, 74 to 2012.
You're 74 years old?
Four, I'm 38
what
years
did you make?
Old. I've been making movies
movie?
38.
No, with him, how many? When did you start?
Oh, Bound for Glory was my first movie. Jurassic Park. But Amazing Stories is the first thing. But, you know, I think the thing that all of us feel is that we like where we've been, but we're not hung up on where we've been. We're all kind of projecting forward, and that's because that's what he does. And I think that's been a really good guide for all of us, is to keep moving forward. Each one of these movies is very different. I'd say War Horse and Lincoln complement each other in an interesting way, being back-to-back. But just over time, I think it's been great to see him evolve in his artistry and where he, you know, finds, you know, inspiration. So as I get older, I really appreciate that. That really matters to me. But at least it's about projecting forward.
And do you all have a sense of legacy outside of your group? I mean, you're all part of this phenomenon, this director who has such a place in history here. Do you have a sense of how the rest of the world is watching him or seeing him or putting him in a perspective, or is it even relevant? You're too busy working.
I don't actually really think about that in that way.
I think that, you know, there is, yes, I think about that sometimes, because I think if you say to, wherever you are in the world, if you say to somebody you're working on a Steven Spielberg film, you know, he is probably the one name universally that has, you know, he's known wherever.
Him and Coca-Cola.
Like Coca-Cola. Yeah, I mean, I spend quite a lot of time in East Africa and, you know, they all know him there. He's never been there.
Yes, I mean, there's that, but I don't think, I think of Steven as being who he is, and in those terms, but I don't think of myself as fitting into that. I see myself as being asked on occasion, and never presume that I'll be asked again, but every time you are, it's a privilege and a thrill. I mean, that's, but I don't see myself as being anywhere near that kind of. I mean, I do my job, hopefully well, you know.
One of the things that I got from watching this movie my fifth time Now I'm past watching the background, and I'm back to watching all the actors. The story. But I'm doing it from a slightly different thing, because the level is I could actually recite a bunch of the lines. But for instance, just the way Lincoln looks in a close-up, you can stay with that, and partly that's because of what he's doing and mm-hmm. what he's saying. But the way he looks, that scruffiness, that is, you know, the way I've never seen, even, and I've examined the pictures, the way his beard and his sideburns come together, it all makes sense on his face. The way his whiskers are underneath, the way that I was tracking that mole this last time, and seeing how perfect it was every time, and never too much. It was like a choice not to make it everything an exaggeration, but so subtle. And then you get into that roughness of his shirt, and then his coat, and then the shawl, and then the silhouette that he creates, and you see it in various ways. And then of course there's the top hat, and then that whole building of the icon that's spread out throughout the movie, that's of course in the words and in the performance, but I think that the sense of that man coming forth with all those details, and also that he represents a rough frontier version of the president, which was new, and that was an affront to the Virginia aristocracy and all of the people that were of that sort of more refined East Coast, more direct from, no offense, Britain, and now could, in an expanding the nation at that time, could the democracy hold? And it was on the edge of not being able to. And it took this guy who was actually described as a monkey in the press.
Yes.
You know, and being a ruffian, and the scenes that you see in the movie about the trouble that Mary had with the House Ways and Means Committee going way over budget. Those kinds of things, I think, are all in his face. And they're also the types of things that resonate out as you look at all the other characters. You can almost figure them out as to, you know, how high in the aristocracy are they? What do they represent? And I like that. I think that that's a subliminal level that the movie is functioning on that only would happen in a movie that's so much of a portrait.
What's all that work that you guys put in that we're not supposed to?
We had some white shirt too. We had some white, not just a portrait.
Yeah, but I think that what Daniel delivers from within, as well as the exterior, there's that sort of other, you know, we can do what we do, but I mean.
But it all adds to it. I mean, the more, if we're thinking about it, it's not a very good movie, I think is the rule of thumb.
Yeah. Right.
And when he's walking down that hallway, and it's a shot of his back, and you're not seeing his face, and he's not, you know, acting, quote unquote, the power of that moment and the realization that he's a man and not just an icon is so powerful, but all those other pieces not coming before it would not, you know, you wouldn't be there.
But the thing is that we actually, I mean, although, well, that's really not my process to say, but I have to say, I felt that I was doing makeup on Mr. Lincoln. I can't describe it in another way other than that. And it wasn't just the fact that we called him Mr. Lincoln. But that's what it was like. It was astounding. He is an astounding actor. He's sort of almost the embodiment of what an actor is. And at the same time, isn't like an actor at all. Did you not think?
Yeah, I think we all got our cue at that level. I think it made all of us a lot more sober and did our jobs because, like, even Stephen was wearing a tie to work every day.
Sober, we were respectful. Like you're playing like we've been drinking.
Yeah, his own version of a frock coat was absolutely lovely.
Stephen, you were walking, you know, obviously Stephen, sober.
Stephen was sober.
We're not drinking.
I know. that was the point.
But after work.
No, we didn't drink.
No.
No,
I think
drink.
For 4 months, that's my point.
You were all in that place together.
Yeah.
Yes.
They shouldn't.